Focus here really is on Donald Trump, and I've said from the get-go, I'm going to try my best to really focus on the president and his character and not so much the people around him. But it won't surprise you when I say that a lot of people in private are silent around the president, all right? When he makes an absurd claim, whether it's in the Oval Office or at an event that we would be at with him, far too often people would sit there with their mouths closed and they would sort of just laugh or, you know, shift uncomfortably in their seats when they probably should have spoken up. A lot of the people who used to speak up are largely gone from this administration.
Yeah, I mean, we witnessed that firsthand when the president suggested at the podium that there should be experiments on our citizens with injecting bleach into them to possibly cure them of coronavirus or treat them of coronavirus. And he actually, you know, turned to Dr. Birx was there, another official, from HHS was there, a public health official. And Dr. Birx clearly was just, you know, silent and looking down, and the other official said, "Oh yeah, you know, we'll essentially look into that." I was fascinated by the president when he was asked about QAnon finally, because it's obviously been percolating for a long time. His first response was, "They say very nice things about me," which I thought was so telling, which is something he says a lot. That seems to be the lens through which he views anybody, any group or any individual. They say nice things about me, so therefore I'm not going to say terrible things about them as long as they say nice things about me.
Sure. I mean, Anderson, look back at Charlottesville. I think that we just marked the third anniversary of Charlottesville, and at the time, administration officials, myself included, were astounded that the president embraced some of these radical right-wing elements when he should have condemned them. But we all know now why he embraced them, because these are people who expressed support for President Trump. And he's so drawn to that, he doesn't really care what they say. I mean, this is not a one-time thing. We're at the point now where this is very, very emblematic of Donald Trump's character. And the QAnon episode is just one more example in a long line of episodes that extend before Charlottesville and since then.
Just one more thing on QAnon. They believe that President Trump is behind the scenes working to stop this cabal of global sex traffickers, Democratic officials, and that he is secretly, you know, he used to be secretly working with the Mueller team to get subpoenas against Democrats, and that there was going to be this widespread purge. You worked at the Department of Homeland Security. Is President Trump involved in, obviously the U.S. works on sex trafficking issues around the globe, thankfully, because it is an actual problem. But is he actually running, fight against this cabal, this alleged cabal of Satan-worshipping people who drink the blood of children?
I mean, this is what's so surreal, Anderson. We're talking about this, and real Americans out there believe it because the president says it. I mean, that's why words matter, and that's why his use of words is extremely irresponsible. Then the answer is no, okay? I helped run a department of 250,000 hardworking men and women that protect this country every day. DHS is the largest law enforcement organization in America. I saw no indication whatsoever, not only of a QAnon cabal of sex traffickers, but I didn't see a deep state working against the president. I didn't see any of these things that he regularly reverts to as conspiracy theories. It is not real. And we should recognize that when the president of the United States, the leader of the free world, is overtaken by these carnival barkers, that it's probably going to have deleterious consequences for our nation's security. And certainly, I can tell you, it had a huge impact on morale in our department and throughout the federal government.
There's a new report that suggests that Trump officials actually held a vote in 2018 during a White House meeting on whether to separate migrant families. Can you expand on that? Do you know about that?
Yeah, I could expand on it far beyond our program, but let me try to give you the shorter version. At the very beginning of the administration, the White House pushed DHS, when John Kelly was secretary, to institute a policy of ripping kids apart from their parents at the border. It didn't matter whether they showed up at a port of entry or crossed illegally. They said, let's rip them apart, and that'll scare migrants so that they don't show up at the border. Kelly rejected that out of hand. Nielsen rejected that out of hand. So what the attorney general in the White House decided to do was they said, well, look, we'll just prosecute everyone who crosses illegally. that ended up having the effect, because there weren't enough resources to process people quickly, of leaving them apart from their children for an unacceptably long period of time. Secretary Nielsen at the time was very, very concerned about that potential backlog after the Attorney General announced the policy. She pushed back against the White House again and again. The White House got so frustrated that finally, at that date in the spring, they sat down with a number of members of the cabinet and senior staff, and they held a vote. And they said, look, you know, Secretary Nielsen says we're not ready, but do you all think we're ready? Do we have the resources to do this? Look, I wasn't in the room for that, but I was very aware after the fact. I'd heard readouts from those conversations. She was the one individual who said, no, I'm not raising my hand. We are not ready to do this. She was outvoted, and the Department of Homeland Security was put in the impossible position of implementing this policy and trying to do it quickly enough so that children wouldn't be apart from their parents for an unacceptably long period of time while they went through the justice system. Mm-hmm. This is a textbook example of how policymaking went wrong in the Trump administration, and it emanated from the top. The president is responsible for this. Now, granted, a lot of us, some of this is on us, right? I mean, we could have done more to pump the brakes. The secretary certainly tried to behind the scenes. And then finally, rightfully, we convinced the president to sign an executive order that summer ending the policy. But as I've said before, Anderson, almost every single month that we were in the administration after that, the president said he wanted to reinstitute the policy and go further and revert back to that version they'd proposed in year one, that sickening version of let's just rip them apart to scare migrants from coming to the border. That was one of the reasons that I ended up leaving this administration.
You also have talked about what happened behind the scenes when the president threatened to, quote, bus and dump immigrants in sanctuary cities, which was he talked about. I mean, that was highly reported. What was going on behind the scenes with that?
So in roughly February of 2019, the president called us and he said exactly those words you just used. He said he wanted us to bus and dump all the illegal immigrants we picked up at the border and go drop them in Democratic sanctuary cities, basically a way to punish these cities because they would refuse to turn over illegal immigrants to Immigration and Customs Enforcement. We had our lawyers look at this. Anderson, we didn't need to have our lawyers look at this. This was patently illegal on its face. This would be misuse of federal funds. That's not a legitimate law enforcement operation. So I was the one who personally went back to the White House, to the Chief of Staff's office, to several other senior advisors' offices, and I said, listen, we think this is illegal. You need to let the president know this is not legal. The president called us again and said, you need to do this. The secretary at the time said, no, sir, we're not able to do this. And of course, as is the case in the Trump administration, within days, as I remember, the president went out and tweeted that this policy idea was actively under consideration, even though we had told him it was illegal. Anderson, this won't even be on page 14 of any newspaper today. But again, we have another example of the president of the United States being told something is unlawful to do, yet he'll still try to go forward and implement those types of policies. Mm. There's a litany of examples of him embracing and trying to pursue illegal behavior.
We all know that the president watches a lot of television. You say that one host served as the de facto chief of staff.
Yeah, this is really disheartening, but there was a period of time where, you know, at first jokingly, we would say that Fox late night host Lou Dobbs was the sort of shadow chief of staff of the Trump administration. Why did we say that? Because the president would call us and he would say, and pardon my language, he would say, why the hell didn't you watch Lou Dobbs last night? You need to listen to Lou. What Lou says is what I want to do. So if Lou Dobbs peddled a conspiracy theory on late night television or made an erroneous claim about what should be done either at the border or with some law enforcement operation, the president wanted us to be tuning in every night. My response to that was, I don't have any time to watch Lou Dobbs in the evening. You've got us running a 250,000 person department, and we're trying to play, we're trying to guard against some of the most severe threats to this country. We can't be watching Lou Dobbs and taking our orders from him, but this happened on a regular basis. Mm.
You also talked about a meeting involving school violence that didn't go well.
Well, this is an example, Anderson, of the president being unable to focus on things that are very important. I think this was around the end of 2018. We went to meet with the president to talk about a very important issue, school safety. Okay, our mission was to tell him what the recommendations we had developed were around keeping kids from being shot in classrooms around our country. All right, a sobering meeting, an important subject. We went in to discuss it. Within minutes of bringing up the subject, the president was instantly distracted, wanted to talk about the wall. And in fact, the words he used that day were, he said, "I want my wall to be a beautiful work of art, a beautiful work of art. Go make it a work of art. And here's how to design it." I'm sitting there in my hands with recommendations about how to keep our nation's children safe in their classrooms. The president doesn't want to talk about that. He wants to talk about the aesthetics of his border wall. This says a lot about his priorities. This says a lot about his indiscipline.